In this video, we're going to take a little detour in our study of the history of quantum mechanics to look specifically at x-rays. So like the discovery of x-rays and how x-rays are produced, because the way they are produced when they were discovered is the same way that they're produced today. So in 1895, there's a scientist named Wilhelm Röntgen who's studying cathode rays using a Lenard tube. And a Lenard tube was invented by Philip Lenard, the same guy that we talked about who had his quarrel with Einstein, right? Same guy. He was one of the chief investigators of cathode rays, and Rontgen was doing his own studies, right? So first off, let's look at what this setup looked like. Okay, so what the whole setup was, basically a glass tube. And so originally they were just glass tubes. You put two electrodes in, and when you put a voltage across them, they noticed there were these rays that would come off of the cathode towards the anode, right? And so of course they called them cathode rays because they came from the cathode. But eventually, Lenard figured out that if I put a metal window here, the cathode rays wouldn't interact with the window as much as they did with the glass, and they could let the cathode rays come out of the metal window, and they could study the cathode rays in air. What they didn't realize was that by putting this metal window here, the cathode rays were interacting with it in a way they couldn't see, and nobody had discovered that. And nobody figured it out until Rontgen, because everybody was so focused on looking at cathode rays. So in reality, nowadays, we know that cathode rays are really electrons. So what was happening was electrons were being pulled off the anode, and J.J. Thompson figured this out in 1897. So anyways, on the night of November 8th, 1895, Wilhelm Rontgen is doing this experiment in his lab in the basement in the middle of the night, right? So they wanted to do it nighttime because when these rays would come out, what they would do is expose them to these glow-in-the-dark plates so that they could see, you know, how far they went, and they could make all sorts of other measurements. And it was easier, instead of covering your whole apparatus up, to just do it when it's dark outside. You don't have to worry so much about outside light. So he's doing this experiment, right? And he has a photographic plate on the side of his lab over here, you know, like 10 feet away. And when he's doing this, he notices out of the corner of his eye that this plate over here is starting to glow. So he's doing this experiment. He just sees out of the corner of his eye it's starting to glow, and he thinks, what's going on there? Right? And so he does what any good scientist does when they think they've made the first discovery. He locks himself in and starts doing all these tests in secret. So the biggest thing that caught him here is that this plate was several feet away, like on the other side of his lab, and this thing is glowing. Cathode rays at the time were only known to go, you know, a few inches outside, and then the air molecules they interact with, they dissipate, right? So cathode rays couldn't have gone this far. So he knows he's got to be looking at some other ray. So he does some tests, and eventually he calls his wife down, and he tells his wife to come help him out with an experiment. So he has his wife put her hand in front of the photographic plate, and then he turns this thing on, and he exposes her hand to the x-rays for 15 minutes, right? So when you go get an x-ray at the doctor's, they expose you for maybe like a second on, a second off. He put his wife's hand there for 15 minutes, and, you know, they didn't know the dangers of this at the time, but when he did this, he sees this ghostly image of her hand, and you can see her bones, and you can see a faint outline of the skin, and you can see the ring on her hand. Okay, so he calls his new ray an X-ray, X meaning like an unknown variable in math. And he knows that it's got to be something different because he does a bunch more tests, and he starts putting like lenses and stuff in front of them to see if they diffract and refract like visible light does. And it doesn't work like that. He puts magnets to see if magnets have any effect, because if you put magnets next to cathode rays will bend because they're charged particles, right? They're electrons. But when he put magnets next to his x-rays, nothing happened. And he also noticed the density of the stuff that the x-rays were going through was a direct proportion to how much x-rays was absorbed. So when you look at a picture of an x-ray, what you're seeing is an exposed image. So the bone that you see isn't exposed because it's absorbed all the x-rays, because your bones are heavier things like calcium, right? But the x-rays will travel through your skin and your muscle, because your skin and your muscle and that kind of stuff is mostly water. And so you end up with a negative that shows where the bones are, because the bones blocked all the x-rays from developing the paper. So he publishes his paper in like December of 1895, and he becomes instantly famous because people realize that this is going to be a really huge thing, especially for medicine, right? So let's look at what's actually happening here. So the key to all of this is this metal window. So electrons are flying towards this metal window, and they're interacting with the atoms in the metal in two different ways. So the first way is a bremsstrahlung interaction. Bremsstrahlung radiation, or if you want to be fancy and say it in German, you can say bremsstrahlung. Bremsstrahlung radiation happens when these electrons get deflected by the nuclei in the metal window, right? So imagine here's an electron that's flying by, and here's a nucleus, and the nucleus is positively charged, right? So this electron comes flying by here, but it's going to interact with this positive nucleus, right? And it's going to cause the particle to bend its path and come down this way. So in order to conserve energy, because this thing has turned, it gives off an X-ray. That's a bremsstrahlung interaction, right? And it's called breaking radiation because you can do it, you know, let's say an electron did this, came in this way, and it slowed down and then turned around and came back out this way. There'd have to be an X-ray photon emitted this way to conserve energy, right? So breaking radiation or bremsstrahlung radiation is one interaction. The other type of interaction actually happens if an electron slams into an atom. So if you picture an atom here, right, and we have some energy levels, if I have an electron come in here and slam into this electron and make it leave, then I have an empty shell, right? And what's going to happen is an electron from that atom will drop down and it'll create an X-ray. So this is called characteristic interactions. So when you look at the net result of all of this, I have these electrons flying towards here and they're interacting either through bremsstrahlung interactions or characteristic interactions. You get X-rays that fly all over the place from this window, right? So there's X-rays flying out in all directions. And they're all different kinds of X-rays, right? But if I look at all these interactions, kind of like we did when we talked about blackbody radiation, I can graph the frequency versus the intensity of different types of X-rays, right? And so when I look at the energy of the X-rays that come off versus the intensity, the graph kind of looks something like this. It's kind of a curve and it's got these peaks on it, right? So there's a point where you have the most energetic X-ray, but there's also these two little peaks. So the bremsstrahlung interactions, those are this part right here, this curved part that looks kind of orderly. The characteristic interactions, the one where they actually slam into the metal, that's these peaks. So these peaks correspond with characteristic X-ray radiation. And if you look at the spectrum of different X-rays, these characteristic peaks are going to be different for every metal, kind of like an atomic spectra, right? But the bremsstrahlung curve looks the same for everything because it's just a range of different ways that the electron could slow down when it encounters a nucleus. So nowadays what they do with X-ray tubes, instead of letting these X-rays fly everywhere, they take the tube and encase it in lead and they have an opening so that X-rays will only come out the bottom so you can direct the X-rays so people aren't just getting exposed to X-rays all over the place. So knowing this, we can figure out the maximum energy of an X-ray that's going to get produced from a tube, right? So there's a potential difference between these two plates, right? And this electrical potential energy is going to get converted to the energy of an X-ray. So we can just use conservation of energy and say this electrical energy is equal to the energy of a photon, which is Planck's constant times its frequency, right? And so we'll call this the maximum frequency of an X-ray. Well, the potential energy here is equal to the charge of the things going through times the potential difference. So the formula to figure out the maximum frequency of an X-ray is this. It's the charge times the voltage, charge of the electron, right? So it's basically just 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 equals Planck's constant times the maximum frequency. And with this, I can figure out if I have this X-ray tube, what's the highest energy X-ray that I will produce? Okay, a little bit of history to end this. Röntgen actually won the very first Nobel Prize for this discovery, right? And this pissed off Philip Lenard. Before Lenard got pissed off at Einstein, I mean, he was pissed off at everybody, because if you're a Nazi in Germany in the early 1900s, you're probably pissed off at everyone. But his first feud was with Rontgen, because Rontgen had used his tube to discover X-rays. And so Lenard's whole thing was, well, he's using my tube, and I could have discovered this too, but I was more worried about cathode rays, and it was me, I'm the one who invented this. But he actually started out writing letters to Rontgen saying, oh, this is so great, you discovered this using my tubes. And he thought that Rontgen was going to like write back and say, oh yeah, you're so wonderful, I used your tubes, but I built it all on you, and you're the greatest, right? But Rontgen never did that. And so Lenard started this whole crusade to basically say that he was the one who discovered X-rays instead of Rontgen. So Rontgen died in 1923. And interestingly enough, when he did die, in his will, he wanted all of his scientific papers to be destroyed, right? I don't know why, but he saved the papers that Lenard had sent him, destroyed everything except for the correspondences with Lenard, because I think he knew that Lenard wasn't happy with this and he was going to try to get him erased from the history books.